Hello everyone, this is Meenakshi Dilip Birari, working as assistant professor in chemistry at Maratha Vidya Prasarak Samaj, Nasik. We know that there are 16 elements required for proper growth of crops. Out of these, three essential nutrients are carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. The remaining 13 nutrients are taken up from the soil and usually grouped as primary nutrients, secondary nutrients and micronutrients. In previous lectures, we have discussed primary nutrients, that is nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. Also, the role of these nutrients related to plant growth and deficiency symptoms. Today, we are going to discuss secondary nutrients, calcium, magnesium, sulfur, and also the role of these nutrients related to plant growth and what happens if these nutrients are deficient in plants. So let's see in detail about secondary nutrients, calcium, magnesium and sulfur. We know that 16 elements are grouped into primary nutrients, secondary nutrients, micronutrients and structural elements. Secondary nutrients and primary nutrients both are macronutrients, that means this requires in a larger quantity. Secondary macronutrients are just as important as primary macronutrients, but they are needed in smaller quantities as compared to primary nutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. The secondary micronutrients are calcium, magnesium and sulfur. These nutrient deficiencies are increasingly becoming an important limiting factor in intensive crop production systems, especially in soils fertilized only with nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. The secondary nutrient deficiencies are also increasingly becoming an important limiting factor related to crop production systems. We will discuss in detail about these secondary nutrients one by one. First of all, calcium. Calcium is an essential secondary plant nutrient. As the divalent cation, that is Ca2+, it is required for structural roles in the cell wall and membranes. Calcium is absorbed by plants in the form of bivalent ion, that is Ca2+ ions. This may occur from the soil solution or also by the process of contact exchange. The calcium is also an important nutrient for cell division. The minerals like calcite, apatite, dolomite and feldspar releases Ca2+ ions which may be absorbed by organisms, lost in drainage water, absorbed on the exchange complex or also reprecipitated as a secondary compounds. Now what is the role of calcium in plants? Calcium is constituent of the cell wall, hence it increases the stiffness of plants. It has an essential for cell elongation and division, cell division. Calcium accumulates during respiration by mitochondria and also it increases their protein content. Calcium improves the uptake of other plant nutrients like nitrogen and also micronutrients like iron, copper, zinc and manganese. Calcium plays an important role in the structure and permeability of cell membranes. Calcium enhances the uptake of nitrate nitrogen and therefore is interrelated with nitrogen metabolism also. Calcium is directly involved in chromosome stability and also it is a constituent of chromosome structure. It also affects the translocation of carbohydrates in plants. It promotes the early root development and also the growth of the plant. Calcium influences the weaker economy of the plant, protein-carbohydrate ratio in fat metabolism, as well as many other physiological processes. Calcium also encourages the seed production. So, if we consider the functions or the role of calcium in plants, calcium is a constituent of the cell wall and due to that it increases the stiffness of the plants. It improves the uptake of other plant nutrients like nitrogen and other micronutrients. It encourages the seed production, promotes the early root development and growth of the plant. Calcium also influences the weaker economy of the plant, protein-carbohydrate ratio in fat metabolism, as well as many other physiological processes. The calcium plays an important role in the structure and also in permeability of cell membranes. So these are the various things we should remember. What are the different functions of calcium in plants? Now, if the calcium is deficient, so what are the deficiency symptoms which are observed in plants? Calcium deficiency symptoms appear in the meristem regions. Meristem regions, that means from which the new growth it occurs, like the meristem regions of leaves, stems, buds and roots. So the calcium deficiency symptoms firstly appear in the meristem regions. Younger leaves are affected first and also usually deform due to the deficiency of calcium. In extreme cases, the growing tips die and the leaves of some plants hook downward and exhibit the marginal necrosis due to the deficiency of calcium. If we consider the roots of calcium deficient plant, that becomes short and steady. So, if we consider the deficiency symptoms in particularly in the leaves, also in extreme cases, the growing tips die whenever the calcium is deficient and the leaves of some plants also becomes hooked downward and exhibit the marginal necrosis. So, these are the various images by observing that we'll get what are the deficiency symptoms related to calcium. Roots becomes short and steady. The leaves shows the marginal necrosis or in some plants hook downward of leaves. So these are again the another deficiency symptoms we can observe in these images. Here the spotting, loss of coloration due to the deficiency of calcium. This one is the particular symptom observed in tomato plant. In tomatoes and peppers, a black leathery appearance develops on the blossom end of the fruit and this disorder, which is called as blossom end rot, particularly in tomatoes and in peppers due to the deficiency of calcium. In tomatoes, a black leathery appearance develops and that is called as a blossom end rot. In such cases, the fruit ceases to develop and also eventually falls off. When we consider the another example, in peanuts, low calcium causes pops. What is that? It is a particular deficiency symptoms observed in peanuts. Low calcium causes pops, which is a condition that prevents the nuts from developing. That means the development of nuts do not occur if the calcium is deficient in peanuts. So we can observe here, this one is the blossom end rot, a disorder observed in the tomatoes or also in the peppers. A black leathery appearance here, black leathery appearance develops on the blossom end of the fruit In such cases, the fruit ceases to develop and eventually falls off. And in peanuts, the low calcium causes pops. So there is the condition that prevents the nuts from developing. So we can observe here, this development of the nut do not occurs due to the deficiency of calcium. So this disorder or that deficiency symptom is, it is particularly in peanuts called as a pops. And here in tomatoes, blossom end rot. Now, how we can correct the deficiency of calcium? So, by application of fertilizers, we can remove the deficiency related to the calcium in plants. Plants must contain calcium from the soil. And soil reserves are maintained with frequent application of lime. Calcium can also be supplied by applying the fertilizers. Various types of the calcium fertilizers are applied. Calcium nitrate, calcium sulfate, normal superphosphate. These are the various fertilizers can be applied to correct the deficiency of calcium. Calcium deficiency generally indicates that there is a need of lime. That means soil is properly lime will provide the calcium for several years for crops like peanuts that require a high calcium concentration. So we should remember that calcium deficiency is generally an indication of the need of lime. So the soils that are properly lime will provide the adequate calcium for several years for crops like peanuts, which requires a higher quantity of calcium concentration. By banded or broadcast application of gypsum will supply the adequate calcium for the normal crop production. So for certain crops, a foliar application of calcium nitrate is also effective in correcting deficiency. So we should remember that if the calcium deficiency observed, it indicates that there is a need of lime. So that is one of the macronutrient, secondary nutrient calcium. Secondly, we will discuss about magnesium, which is also secondary nutrient, macronutrient. Magnesium is an essential component of the chlorophyll molecule, with each molecule containing 6.7% of magnesium. It is essential for photosynthesis, cell division, protein formation, phosphate metabolism, plant respiration, and also in the activation of several enzyme systems. Magnesium is also absorbed by plants in the form of Mg2+ ions. The absorption takes place from the soil solution and by the mechanism of cation exchange. The various forms in which the magnesium exists in soil, that may be mineral form, exchangeable Mg2+, or water soluble Mg2+. Magnesium, it is absorbed by the plants in the form of Mg2+ ions. So what are the roles or the functions related to magnesium in plants? Magnesium is a constituent of chlorophyll molecule, which is the driving force of photosynthesis. It imparts dark green color in leaves. Magnesium, it is a mobile element and it is readily passed from older to younger part of the plant during its deficiency. Magnesium is also responsible for the uptake of phosphorus and also regulates the uptake of other nutrients. Magnesium also activates the formation of polypeptide chains from amino acids. Magnesium also serves as a structural component in ribosomes. It appears to stabilize the ribosomal particles in the configuration necessary for protein synthesis. It also plays an important role for the formation of carbohydrates, fats and vitamins, etc. It act as a cofactor for certain enzymes other than those involved in phosphate transfer. It has vital role in the activation of enzyme carboxylase, which is found in chloroplast. Magnesium also increases the affinity of enzymes for carbon dioxide. Magnesium is involved in a number of physiological and biochemical functions. So these are the various functions related to magnesium in plants. It is a constituent of chlorophyll molecule. It is a driving force related to the process of photosynthesis. It also imparts the dark green color in leaves. It is a mobile element so that it readily passes on from older to younger plants during its deficiency. It is also important in the uptake of phosphorus and regulates the uptake of other nutrients. It also serves as a structural component in ribosomes. It acts as a cofactor for certain enzymes. Also, to activate the enzyme carboxylase, which is found in chloroplast, magnesium plays an important role. It increases the affinity of enzymes for carbon dioxide. So, these are the functions of magnesium in plants. Now, what happens if the magnesium is deficient in particular plant? So, what are the deficiency symptoms of magnesium in plants? The predominant symptom is interveinal chlorosis. That means the dark green color or the dark green veins with yellow areas between the veins. It is observed due to the deficiency of magnesium. So it is the predominant symptom of magnesium in plants, that is interveinal chlorosis. Chlorotic leaves generally turns red and they develop spotted necrotic areas. Magnesium deficiency in plants usually appear first in older leaves, showing that magnesium is mobile element. Mg is mobile in plants, that means it readily passed on from older to younger plant during its deficiency. The bottom leaves are affected first. As the deficiency becomes more acute, the symptoms progress up the plant. So these are the particular things which are observed in various plants. Here, this one is interveinal chlorosis. Dark green veins with yellow areas between the veins. So here we can observe yellow areas between the veins, interveinal bleeding or interveinal chlorosis. Older leaves, when we observe purpling of the lower or older leaves due to the deficiency of magnesium. So chlorotic leaves generally turns red and they develop spotted necrotic areas. Here necrotic leaf edges, again we can get the coloration, red coloration and spotted necrotic area. Some crops sensitive to magnesium deficiency are jute, grapes, sugar beet, potatoes, citrus fruits and vegetables. On tobacco, symptoms begin on the tips of the lower leaves and progress across entire leaf. Magnesium deficiency is the common cause of grass tetany in ruminants. So these are the symptoms observed in these plants. Some crops sensitive to magnesium deficiency, these are jute, grapes, sugar beet, potatoes, citrus fruits and also the vegetables. So it is observed in potato, here in citrus fruits, in tobacco plants. On tobacco, symptoms begin on the tips of the lower leaves and progress across entire leaf. So if you observe here, the low magnesium having the faint coloration of leaves and adequate magnesium having the dark green color of the leaves. That means the interveinal chlorosis, dark green veins with yellow areas between the veins can be observed if the magnesium is lower or deficient in plants. Now, by which method we can correct the deficiency of magnesium? So, by the application of fertilizers, we can correct the deficiency of magnesium in plants. So, deficiency symptoms are commonly occur on very sandy soil during the periods of excessive rainfall. It also occurs if the soil pH is low or if only calcite lime has been applied. So, depending on the stage of growth of crop, this can be corrected by soil application of lime or by the application of fertilizers. So, what are the examples of magnesium containing fertilizers? Usually, Mg is applied to the soil by use of commercial fertilizer, that is MgSO4 magnesium sulfate or dolomite lime, which contains 6 to 9% of magnesium. So, depending on the stage of growth of crop, this can be corrected by soil application of lime or also by the application of various fertilizers. Commercial fertilizer used to correct the deficiency of magnesium, it is MgSO4 or dolomite lime, which contain 6 to 9% of magnesium. Now, the another secondary nutrient, that is sulfur. So, let's see in detail about secondary macronutrient sulfur. Sulfur is absorbed primarily in the sulfate form, that is in the form of SO4-2- and SO2 gas by plants. It is a part of every living cell and required for synthesis of amino acids and proteins. Sulfur is also important in photosynthesis and crop winter hardiness. Leguminous plants need sulfur for efficient nitrogen fixation. It also increases the size and weight of grain crops and enhances the deficiency of nitrogen for protein manufacture. Sulfur increases the yield and protein quality of forage and grain crops along with production and quality of fiber crops. So, we should remember that sulfur is absorbed primarily in the form of sulfate, that is SO4-2- and in the form of SO2 gas. It is found in organic forms in number of crops like onion, in garlic, cabbage, etc. Sulfur is essential for the growth and development of all crops and it is absorbed through the roots in the form of sulfate. Sulfur, it is an immobile nutrient. Now let's see the role of sulfur in plants. Sulfur stimulates the root growth, seed formation and also nodule formation. Sulfur is involved in the formation of chlorophyll, but it is not constituent of chlorophyll. It helps in the formation of metabolites including coenzyme A, vitamin B and glutathione. It is a part of pyridoxine, a type of non-heme iron sulfate protein occurring in the chloroplast, which is important. Sulfur improves the quality of all types of crops and also vegetables. So, we should remember that sulfur, it is helpful in the formation of metabolites including coenzyme A or vitamin B and glutathione. It is a vital part of pyridoxine. It also improves the quality of all types of crops and vegetables. It stimulates the root growth, seed formation and nodule formation. It is also involved in the formation of chlorophyll. So these are the different things related to role of sulfur in plants. Now what happens if the sulfur is deficient? Sulfur deficiency symptoms. Let's see. Sulfur deficiency is characterized by stunted growth, delayed maturity, yellowing of plants, and also an acute sulfur deficiency causes entire plant to turn yellow. The deficiency of sulfur result in uniform chlorosis, which affects all the portions of leaves excepting the tips. So when we consider here the sulfur deficient plant, it is the normal plant. Sulfur deficient plant, in that an acute sulfur deficiency causes the entire plant to turn yellow. The deficiency is also characterized by stunted growth, delay maturity, and it results in uniform chlorosis, which affects all portions of the leaves excepting the tips also. Sulfur deficiency symptoms begin in the younger and upper leaves first. It also resembles to those of nitrogen, in that they produce the pale yellow or light green leaves. So already we have discussed the nitrogen deficiency symptoms. The sulfur deficiency symptoms are also similar to those of nitrogen deficient plant. That means they also produce the pale yellow or light green coloration in the leaves. In crops like corn, grains size is small, and also yellow strips that run parallel to the leaf blade are common sulfur deficiency. So grain size reduces or decreases due to the deficiency of sulfur. Also yellow strips that run parallel to the leaf blade are common sulfur deficiency. So these are the pictures. By observing that, we'll get the formation of leaves, which produces the pale yellow or light green coloration, and yellow strips that run parallel to the leaf blade due to the deficiency of sulfur. So here also we can observe the sulfur deficiency in plants, particularly in the leaves, pale yellow coloration. We can correct the deficiency of sulfur by the application of fertilizers. So which are the fertilizers used to remove deficiency of sulfur? Fertilizers that provide the sulfur, it includes potassium sulfate, K2SO4, K2MgSO4 twice, gypsum, ammonium sulfate, elemental sulfur, it is also used, which contains the 90% of sulfur, 15 to 25 lbs per acre. So in detail we have discussed secondary macronutrients, calcium, magnesium and sulfur. Also we have discussed the role of each nutrient in plants and what happens if these nutrients are deficient in plants. So we have studied secondary macronutrients, calcium, magnesium and sulfur. So calcium, magnesium and sulfur are essential plant nutrients. They are called secondary nutrients because plants require them in smaller quantities than nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. Each plant prefers a specific pH range to be able to access the nutrients in the soil. If the soil pH is too acidic or alkaline, the plant will not be able to take up nutrients, no matter how rich your soil may be. So pH should be close to 7 for better absorption of nutrients. So we have discussed in detail about primary nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. Also secondary nutrients, calcium, magnesium and sulfur. So in next lecture we will discuss the micronutrients, total 7 micronutrients in detail.